Would you care to try something more robust?
Good morning. Welcome to Fall City. You guys can go ahead and stand.
And I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. And I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. And I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. And I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
City, we are glad that you are with us this morning. If you're joining us over Facebook or YouTube Live, we're glad that you're here with us in that way. Please remember to like, share, so we can get the word out. So we are in, I think this is the last Sunday of our series. Yep, last Sunday of our series of Is Your Thankful Tank Full? So we're excited to get ready in the Thanksgiving. This is the week of Thanksgiving, super exciting. With that being said, if you need anything, I know the holidays are coming up. If you know someone that needs something, please don't hesitate to reach out. Find Tim, Adam, or Quentin. We want to be a church that helps the community and reaches out. So if you know someone or if you are someone that is in need of something, please don't hesitate to reach out. We are still offering financial peace. It's completely free. If you're interested in that, please see Quentin. Obviously, COVID-19 is still going on, so make sure when we comes time for communion, you can go back at your own pace and get your communion. Remember to social distance, and also same with offering. Whenever you're ready to give your tithes, you can just go back into that corner and give it at your own time. High school devotional happening at the just 15 minutes after this service for any high schoolers that want to be involved. It's just quick 15 minutes afterwards. Jonah's Jammy is still happening. There's a box out there. If you want to bring in pajamas from size newborn to extra large, please bring those in for Jonah's Jammies. I think that's all there. Anything else, Timmy?
Nope.
I think we're good. All right. With that, we're going to keep going with our worship service this morning.
Let the king of my heart be the mountain where I run, the fountain I drink from, oh, he's my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life, oh, he's my song. And you are good.
Opportunity to dine with his friends, to dine with the 12 that have followed him around for the past 3 years. Jesus has taken this opportunity. He's taken this opportunity to come to the table with us. He's taking the same opportunity to come to the table with us today, just as he did 2,000 years ago. And what's so interesting about the people that were around the table was they were flawed. Peter even told Jesus, he's like, I would never turn my back on you. But he did. And a time after that, which is one of my favorite parts of the Bible because it shows so much of how Christ just comes to us and he wants to be with us and he wants to dine with us. Peter and his friends are out fishing. And Jesus shouts from the shore, "Friends." And he has breakfast already made for them. And Peter can't stand it. He sees his Lord in front of him. And as quick as he possibly can, he dives into the water and he swims. He swims to his Lord and Savior. And one of the first things that Jesus says to Peter, "Do you love me?" And Peter says, "Of course I do, Lord. Of course I do." And Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep." And Jesus says, "Do you love me?" And Peter says, of course. Why do you have to ask me multiple times? Then feed my lambs. Do you love me? Peter, do you love me? And Jesus gets angry, or Peter gets angry, and he says, of course I do, Lord. That's what Jesus is saying in your heart every single day. And we take this time every weekend to reflect on that. And I want you to take the opportunity to reflect on the fact that Jesus chose to be with you no matter your flaws. No matter what you brought to the table, he pulls you to the table. Do you love me? Father, we thank you. We thank you for an opportunity to have a seat at your table. We thank you for the opportunity to just be in your glory. We thank you for the stories that you give us to remind us that we do love you and that we must take every opportunity that we have to reflect the love that you give to us. Speak to our hearts in this time, Lord. Speak to our souls. Speak to the person that we are. And help us to reflect on you. It's in your Son's holy name that we pray. Amen.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies till all my fears are gone. And I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. And I'm no longer chosen me. Love has called my name, and I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. Child of God, I'm no longer a slave to fear. and I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Dear God, I just thank you so much for who you are and what you've done and what you continue to do. And I just thank you so much that we no longer have to be afraid, God. And I just thank you for this church and this community. And I just ask that you'd be with Tim as he brings your message this morning. And I just ask that you'd be with everyone here and who's at home, God, that they would just receive it. And I ask that you would be with everyone during this week, during Thanksgiving, that you would keep everyone safe. And I just thank you so much for how good you are. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Throw a big fat thanks out to the guys who came up and helped us with worship this morning. Things seem to be thinning out. I think everybody's afraid of either Rona or rain. You gonna make it? You all right? Awkward. Hey, you did good through the worship set. I'll give you that. You can be as awkward as you want whenever I'm up here saying whatever it is I'm about to say today. I should probably wrap my sermon real quick. Anyways, so we are in the final week of a series called Is Your Thankful Tankful? Because it's Thanksgiving month, right? And this is the time where, in some ways, the whole world recognizes our need to sit down and think about what it is that we are grateful for, what it is that we're thankful for. And so I think it's a great thing as we hit the holidays that even culture kind of comes to a halt and says, hey, let's think about what we got. Let's think about what we can be grateful for. And then you fast forward another month and the whole world comes to a screeching halt. Why? To celebrate the birth of Jesus. Now, they call it the holidays or whatever, but ultimately, before all the holidays and the season's greeting stuff came in, we came to a screeching halt to celebrate the birth of Jesus. And for a world that predominantly does not believe in Jesus, that is an amazing thing. And we should even be thankful for that, the fact that we are able to freely express the birth of Jesus in the culture that we're in. And so this this final week of Is Your Thankful Tankful, the title of my sermon is Keep Your Fork. And we all know what that means, right? Okay, nobody knows what that means. Awesome. That means there's dessert, y'all, right? You keep your fork because there's dessert. Right? You don't throw your fork in the sink. There's pie, right? There's pie, y'all. Anyways, so big things are coming up this week, right? It's Thanksgiving. It's break out your sweatpants time because you need something with a stretchy waist if you're going to eat all kinds of turkey because it's turkey time. It is tryptophan coma time. You guys know what that is? Tryptophan is the thing that gets triggered inside your body that makes you want to sleep after you eat a whole bunch of turkey. Turkey's got tryptophan in it, so it's tryptophan coma time. It's also time for the Detroit Lions to lose. That's how you know it's really Thanksgiving, is when the Detroit Lions lose. Thanksgiving is a solid holiday, right? You've got some holidays that are holidays, and people don't really get together. They just recognize it as a holiday. But this holiday, food is made, right? It's big enough for people to come out of town and gather together, but it's still small enough that it's kind of intimate, right? So you get to see cousins and stuff like that. I know as a kid, I was always excited when my cousins came to town. Any holiday that we had and my cousins came, there were some high-stakes game of hide-and-go-seek going on. That's just the way it was. And then once we got a Nintendo, then it was high-stakes games of duck hunt. But it's a solid holiday that you get to see extended family, but not so extended that you got crazy Aunt Brenda or Karen or crazy Uncle Rick. There are things that you can count on every year, right? Like whenever you come to Thanksgiving, you can count on the fact that there is a mac and cheese person. That's the person that makes the mac and cheese every year, right? You guys just thought about that person right now. I don't know what their name is, but I'm going to call them mac and cheese person. Anyways, and there's also a person that makes the best mashed potatoes. Now, mashed potatoes, some people like them one way, some people like them the other, but there's like generally one person that makes good mashed potatoes, right? They got just a little bit of lumps in them, but not too much. They're not too creamy. They're not gluey. You can still put enough butter in them, and it doesn't water it down and make it kind of runny. I mean, I might have thought about this a little bit. And there's always someone who is either super offensive or somebody who is super offended, right? Hopefully not at the same time, though, because then it gets stupid, right? That's whenever you have to start doing your Thanksgiving drinking. Somebody ends up with their shirt off and a lampshade on their head. They're screaming Garth Brooks songs at the top of their lungs, and Thanksgiving turns crazy, right? But it's generally a little crowded at Thanksgiving. The kids eat at the smaller table. The adults eat at the big table. Do we have any adults that are still eating at the kids' table? Elizabeth, I knew it. I knew it. And then for some reason, I don't know, those of you who have kids, you know this. For some reason, they manage to get corn everywhere. Like it's all over the place. They can't keep it on their plate. It's on the floor. It's on the table. It's on the cat. I mean, it's all over the place. They get corn everywhere. And for some reason, the person who always has to leave earliest is the same person that showed up earliest, which means everybody has to move their car in order for them to get out so they can go, right? Am I right or am I wrong? I think I've got this down. I think I've observed this for enough that I know what's up. And there are things about Thanksgiving that you can totally count on, right? A lot of those things are things that you can count on. One major thing is dessert, right? You can count on dessert. What's your favorite dessert for Thanksgiving or Christmas? What is it? Pumpkin pie? Basic. No, I'm just kidding. For me, it's either pumpkin pie or the chocolate pie that Aaron's grandma makes. Oh my gosh, depending on my mood on Thanksgiving Day, I will like legit commit a homicide to get some of that chocolate pie. I'll kill somebody. I ain't afraid. I'm crazy. That chocolate pie. You would too if you had a chance to have that chocolate pie. It reminds me that no matter how much we fuss at the kids to get out the door on time, no matter what the parking situation is like at Grandma and Grandpa's, no matter if there's 10 people trying to talk for 3 hours and the TV's way up too loud, no matter if the mac and cheese is too cheesy or not cheesy enough, no matter what, it's going to get sweeter, right? It's going to get sweeter. The day is going to get sweeter because you always have dessert. There's this story in the Bible that I want to dive into. And I'm going to take a different spin, a different angle on it. I don't know if you know this about me, but I'm not too reverent when it comes to that kind of stuff. But I want to take a different angle because as I was reading and kind of unpacking this story in my life, it convicted me. Like it really convicted me. And I'm going to, it gets pretty dark. There's some depressing things. There's some sad things going on. But I'm not going to focus on that stuff as much. All right? We'll hit it a little bit, but I'm not going to focus on the dark stuff as much. And as we go through this, I want us to be reminded to keep our fork. Right? Because something sweeter is coming. You could be thriving through the holidays. It can get better, though. Like, you can think, this doesn't get any better than this. It can, because we're talking about God here, right? Or you could be merely surviving the holidays. But if you hang in there, it's going to get sweeter. It is. It's going to get better. The best is yet to come. Sometimes I hate saying that, but I absolutely believe it. That's the problem. I hate saying it because it sounds so freaking cheesy, right? But I believe it. So the first thing I want to hit today out of this story Have you guys ever owned something or said this phrase? You have somebody over to the house or they get in your car or your truck and you say, well, it ain't much, but it's ours. Anybody ever say that? Me about with everything that I own, right? It ain't much, but I own it. It ain't much, but it's mine, right? And I think there's something both good and bad to that. There's a story of a man named Job, all right? And as you start the book of Job, it jumps in and it says, there once was a man named Job. Well, I kind of already explained that. But who lived in the land of Uz. He was blameless, a man of complete integrity. He feared God and stayed away from evil. He had 7 sons and 3 daughters, all right? He owned 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 teams of oxen, and 500 female donkeys. He also had many servants. He was, in fact, the richest person in that entire area. Sounds a little braggadocious, doesn't it? I mean, really, who needs 500 female donkeys, right? Now, we weren't keeping track of how many donkeys we have, but I want us to stop for a second and actually make a quick mental list of what we do have, right? This started off and it listed what Job had, kind of in detail. It listed all the assets, if you will, that he has. Now, for us, those could be mental, those could be relational, those could be physical assets, but I want you to stop and take a mental note of what it is that you do have. If you have family, it's Thanksgiving. If there's food on the table, if there is a certain tradition, some families, they do all their Thanksgiving stuff, and then whenever the pie has the cling wrap over it and is put in the fridge, we break out the Christmas tree, right? People have those traditions, or they hang up Christmas lights, or mom is on Amazon looking at what to start shopping for, right? We have margin. A lot of us, we don't think about that as an asset, but we have margin. We have time together. We have options. We do. Either I can go or I can not go. If I don't want to sit in my sweatpants and go to grandma and grandpa's, I could just sit in my underwear and stay at my house. Yeah, we all just threw up in our mouth a little bit, didn't we? We have the option of going or not going. We have something to pitch in, right? Whenever you come to dinner, you typically have something that you're responsible for bringing. Something to bring to the table, if you will. For me, that's typically, and those of you who know me, can anybody guess what they are? Nope. I bring rolls everywhere I go. Anyways, it's those little frozen eclairs that you get out of the freezer section, right? Those things are amazing. I only bring them for me, but I bring them nonetheless. I kind of hoard them, and I sit over in the corner, and I'm doing one of these, and I smack hands away, stuff like that. Anyways, but I believe that in this passage, it's important to list what he had, right? And you guys kind of know the story. It's important to list what he had because then we're going to get into listing what he lost. But I think it's important to list what he had. I think it's important for us to sit and list what we have. Because a lot of times we're too busy or we're too overrun by what we don't have that we forget to think about what we do have. Right? Friday begins the shopping season and the focus tends to switch from what we want or what we don't have, or what we need, or what we got to come up with, or what we can find or can't find. It amplifies when you have kids. And so we get kind of caught in that cyclone, and we forget to think about what it is that we have. And before that hits, I think we need to list. I think we need to list what we have. Right? And we might say, it's not much, but it's ours. It allows us the perspective to know that maybe, just maybe, we're a little better off than what we think we are. Right? When you actually list what you have, what you're thankful for, it creates this perspective of gratitude. But a lot of times, we don't take the time. We don't take the time to be thankful. We don't take the time to be grateful. We don't even take the time to recognize what it is that we have. And that's one of the reasons that I love this story, because it starts off by listing the blessings. Imagine if we stepped into everything we did, and first things first, we list the blessings. We list the fact that we can be where we're at and approach things from the angle that we're approaching things because of where God put us. Because I think he put us here on purpose, with a purpose, and for a purpose. Like, I think there's a reason that we're here at this point in time in history, in this place, right now. I think there is. And I believe that was on purpose. And so we need to stop and list the blessings. Well, it ain't much, but it's ours, right? Traditions ain't much, but it's ours. And it may change over the next couple years. But right now, I'm going to hold on to that the best that I can. The second thing is we have memories and responsibilities, right? We have memories and responsibilities. What's some of your best memories about Thanksgiving? Anybody? If you say food, that's cheating because, I mean, come on. We used to sit down and we would camp out in front of the TV and we'd watch the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. I don't know why, but I just always loved it. I always loved watching the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. That was something that we did. It was just on. I was young. I didn't have to worry about cooking anything. I didn't have to worry about bringing anything. I don't even know that the frozen eclairs was a thing back then. So the only thing I had to worry about was sitting down with my bowl of cereal and watching the Thanksgiving parade. Some of y'all wasn't allowed to eat cereal. You weren't allowed to eat until the food was done, right? But we have memories and responsibilities. I have memories, but I also have responsibilities to make new memories, to keep memories alive, to talk about those memories, but also not rest so much on those memories that I don't move forward. So we do have memories, but we also have responsibilities. It says this later on in the story. I long for the years gone by when God took care of me, when he lit up the way before me and I walked safely through the darkness, when I was in my prime, God's friendship was felt in my home. He says, I long for that. The Almighty was still with me. And my children were around me. My steps were awash in cream. I don't even know what the heck that means. Some sort of milk walking thing? I don't know. And he said, the rocks gushed olive oil for me. He says, everything was plenteous. Like God was close to my family, close to my home, close to me. I long for that. And we read this verse and we're like, well, we just listed a bunch of really cool stuff. But this is 28 chapters later, right? We jump ahead 28 chapters and this has gone on. Job, at this point, has lost everything. His kids are dead. His cattle's dead. His 500 female donkeys. Nope, goners, right? To make things worse, the only thing that God really kept alive was a mouthy wife. That's like insult to injury, isn't it? No? The guys are afraid because they're sitting next to their wives. They're not going to laugh at that. But the thing about it is in the beginning, he enlisted what he had, and he was rich. And now he has nothing. He says, I long for the time when I had what? Did he say, I long for the time when I had 500 female donkeys? Nope. When I had all those camels? I long for the time whenever people thought that I was rich. No, he says, I long for the presence of God in my life. Right? after he loses it all, that's what he longs for. He doesn't long for his stuff. He longs for the closeness of God. He wants to feel like God hadn't left him, which God never left. He took a step back, right? He leaves us to our own devices. But he wanted to feel like God hadn't left him because the presence of God was the blessing in all of it, right? So at that moment, if he could list everything that he had once had, everything that he had lost, and everything that he wanted, he would begin and finish with the presence of God. Now, in the midst of the storm, all right, on the first holiday without a loved one, there's often this gaping hole. Trust me, I know, I understand. I remember the first Christmas after my mom died. I walk up to the back door of the house that I grew up in. And I went to open the door and it was locked. Like for the first time in my entire life, I had to knock on the back door of my home that I grew up in. That set the tone for the whole freaking night. Like I was already done. Grandma's lasagna didn't taste the same. The salad sucked. I probably got a stupid gift card to JCPenney. They're not even around anymore, right? I mean, seriously. Like you think about it, you have those things that make a gaping hole. And I know it and I understand it. And I've been there way more times than I would like. I've lost way more than I would like. But there's a couple things to kind of extract from this passage here. First thing, no matter what was lost, no matter who is lost, no matter what happens, God is still God. Like what we lose and what happens in our life does not change who God is. He is still God, he is still good, he is still all-powerful, and he is still the one that poured out his son as a sin offering for us, right? It seems ingenuine to say, especially if those wounds are fresh, especially if you just lost somebody, but let me frame it this way a little bit. Who is your oldest and greatest friend? Like, think about that. Your oldest and greatest friend, and how long have you known them? I would say, now I've got friends that I've been friends with since I was in first grade, but I would say my oldest and greatest friend is my wife. We've been together 20 years. That's how long Aaron and I've been together. We dated for 2 years, and then we've been married for 18 years. It's been awesome sometimes. Over that 20 years, there have been some pretty good fights, like some good ones. Like stupid fights. And to be honest, if I'm looking back, I can't remember what most of them were about. It was stupid in the moment. But in the long haul, it's not been that bad. It's actually strengthened us, right? Because there are so many great moments that I choose to use to define my relationship with my wife over the small moments when we were being people that we weren't at the time, right? When we were being people that we weren't normally at the time. And so there are so many good moments. And if you think about your relationship with God, there are way more good moments than there are moments when you're like, where are you? And you can see that happen. We do that. We're humans. If you read the book of Psalms, it's like one chapter is, God, you are so awesome. You are so close. I think I'm just going to dance in nothing but a loincloth kind of situation, right? And then the next chapter, he's like, where'd you go? Where are you, God? I feel like I am dying inside because you're not around. But would you choose to define your relationship by the good stuff or the bad crap? As a matter of fact, the biggest fight that I can remember with Aaron, like, almost led to divorce, all right, was over a blueberry container. Now, I'd be willing to say there were probably other things that were brewing up behind the scenes, because I don't know of anybody that lost a marriage over a blueberry container. But I want to tell you the story so I can get you guys on my side, because she's not here. All right? So Cooper loves fruit. Like, he'll sit down and eat an entire thing of strawberries in one sitting. And he loves blueberries. And so we get the blueberries, and Aaron's like, well, will you rinse those off? And I'm like, sure. And so I rinse them off in the little container, all right? And then I pour them out on a towel so they can kind of dry, all right? Aaron walks by, and she throws the container on the top of the trash can, and she's like, what are you going to put these in? What do you think I did? I walked over to the trash can, picked up the blueberry container off top of a couple pieces of paper on top of the trash can. There wasn't dookie in there or anything, okay? I picked it up, and I rinsed it off, okay? I rinsed it off in the sink, and I put the blueberries back in there. And then all hell broke loose. It was terrible. Yelling, fighting. I slammed the door. I think like a Halloween decoration that was given as a gift got stuck in there and it bent. I mean, it was stupid, right? But I mean, I'm right, right?
No.
No? Well, Elizabeth doesn't count. She always sides with Aaron. I feel like I'm right. But anyways, but now instead of that thing that could have broken our marriage, right? It's a funny story because of our marriage. That thing that could have brought our relationship to a screeching halt, no matter how stupid it is, all right? And losing a marriage over a blueberry container sounds pretty stupid. It's a funny story now because of our relationship, right? When a relationship is a real relationship, it lasts through stupid stuff. It lasts through hard stuff. It lasts through the good times. It lasts through everything, right? When it's legit, when it's real. Now, Job has this relationship with God, and he's lost everything. He's at this proverbial blueberry container moment with God. But if God is still God, that means that Job's life, his life, okay, he lived to be 140 years old. His life, in comparison to eternity of this relationship with Jesus, of this relationship with God, is just a blip on the screen, all right? So the pain that he feels is just a blip on the screen. But that life is meant to be lived while it can. In other words, as long as the fork is still in your hand, you've got some pie to eat, right? You've got dessert to eat. You've got life to live. You've got things to enjoy. No matter how bad you feel after eating all the other stuff, anybody ever eat till they're miserable? Every time I go to Texas Roadhouse, I hurt walking to the car. It's stupid. But no matter how bad it gets, as long as you got the fork in your hand, you still got dessert to eat. As long as you're breathing, you still have life to live. You still have opportunities to talk freely about the memories, but not to the point where it brings your life to a halt. You have the responsibility to create new traditions, new memories, new opportunities, with maybe even new people sometimes. I was just talking to some friends yesterday, and I have friends from when I grew up. I have friends from kind of previous seasons in my life. But if I could sit down and write out, which I do at least weekly, the friends and families that are the closest to me right now, I wouldn't trade them for anybody in my past. Because I'm creating new memories, new traditions, new opportunities. I'm in a new season with them, right? I've said this several times this past week, that I know things get rough. I know things get unbearable sometimes, but I am more interested in living than I am in just not dying. I'm more interested in living my life than just not dying. Not to mention with every hardship, all right? And I'm not saying this generically. I'm saying this knowing what refinement feels like. With every hardship, with every hit, with every bump, with every broken friendship, broken relationship, lost job, with every cancer diagnosis, whatever it is, God refines us into a purer person through that. One step closer to the person that he originally created us to be. One step closer to the person that we are actually meant to be. Not that person that lives in fear, not that person that just sits on the couch and wishes for the good old days, right? But the person that's stepping into new seasons of life with some of the same people and some new people, and they're creating new memories, right? We're refined, and refinement sucks. Like, refinement comes at high heat and high pressure. How do you think pure gold becomes pure gold? The impurities have to be burnt out of it. It has to be refined down to its pureness. And then it's hammered into something that is value, something that is special, something that is sentimental. And then you add your life situations, your life moments to that, and it makes it even more valuable, right? That's refinement. Check this out. It says, then Job replied to the Lord, I know that you can do anything and that no one can stop you. You asked, who is this that questions my wisdom with such ignorance? It's me. I'm the ignorant one. Who is it that questions me with such ignorance? It is I. And I was talking about things that I knew nothing about, things far too wonderful for me. In the scope of who God is and what God is doing, you are in moments that you could not possibly understand what's going on right now. You are in phases of refinement that feels like they hurt so bad that you will never, ever recover. But he is up to something. He is doing something. It's high pressure, it's high heat, and you feel super ignorant right now. And I'm not trying to be rude, but you are super ignorant right now in a lot of the things that God is doing. You say, listen, and I will speak. I have some questions for you, and you must answer them. I'd only heard about you before, but now I've seen you with my own eyes, and I take back everything that I said, and I set in dust and ashes to show my repentance. He says, yeah, I knew of you, but I didn't know you. And there's a huge difference between knowing of somebody and knowing somebody. My favorite ball player ever, Michael Jordan, I know of him. There was a point in time where I could tell you all of his stats. I collected all of his basketball cards. I wouldn't miss watching a game, but I didn't know him. Things would be a lot different if I actually knew him, right? My shoe game would be tight if I actually knew him, right? But I just know of him. And that's what Job's saying here. He's saying, okay, I knew of you and I didn't quite understand what you were up to, but now I've seen it unfold in my life. And now I know you. I don't just know of you. That refinement started with me whenever we lost Emma. And then when less than a year later, my brother-in-law was killed in an ATV accident. And then less than a year later, my first son was born. And then 2 weeks later, my mom died. And all of a sudden, I'm like, I knew of God. I knew of Jesus. I knew of the things that I heard he could do. I've heard of the Bible stories. Crap, I've taught them for years. But now all of a sudden, I see it. I feel it. It goes from knowing of to knowing. This was kind of his, I'm sorry about what I said when I was hangry moment, right? He's like, I thought you were a jerk. You stood back while Satan took everything from me. And I couldn't understand because according to the first chapter, I was a pretty good dude. But then he's like, ah, I see. I see who you are. I see what you're up to. That's why whenever the fertilizer hits the fan in my life anymore, I don't ask why. I ask, all right, God, what are you up to? What are you doing? How's this going to purify me? Then we need to stop and have those moments. But his loss is what brought him to a greater season in his life. And I know we don't like to think about that. But he would not have the perspective that he has had he not lost what he lost. Had he not realized what he did, right? Had he not taken that moment. I wouldn't be the man that I am. I'm not saying that's great, but it's a lot better than what it was had I not lost what I had lost. I would not be the dad that I am. And I am a bit overbearing at times in the whole dad situation. Had I not lost what I lost. I would not be the husband that I am had I not lost what I lost. I would not be, this is for you, Robin, the son-in-law that I am had I not lost my mom. Brownie points. Get me a JCPenney gift card for Christmas. Anyways, his loss is what brought him to a greater season. And then the last thing you need to know, you keep your fork in your hand because the best is yet to come. Cheesy, I know. I hate saying it. But the thing about it is I believe it. Like I honestly, truly, with every fiber in my being, believe that the best is yet to come. It feels terrible now, but the best is yet to come. It says this, so the Lord blessed Job in the second half of his life even more than in the beginning. He blessed Job more in the second half of his life than even in the beginning. For now he had 1,400 sheep. Holla. He had 6,000 camels, 1,000 teams of oxen, and 1,000 female donkeys. Hello, female donkeys. He also gave Job 7 more sons and 3 more daughters. He named his first daughter Jemima. Eventually she became an aunt. The second, Keziah, and the third, Karen, really? But it's hyphenated, so you know. When it's hyphenated, you know she's a Karen, right? Karen Happick? I don't know. Anyways, in all the land, no women were as lovely as the daughters of Job. And their father put them into his will along with their brothers. Job lived 140 years after that, living to see 4 generations of his grandchildren and grandchildren. Then he died an old man who had lived a long in full life. And this is the part that I've been trying to get to all this time, but ADD made me take the long way around. Anyways, so I love this part because this passage is super rich. Like it is super rich. First, more donkeys. I'm just kidding. Anyways, but it does say that God blessed the second part of Job's life more than the first part of Job's life. And in the first part, it said that he was the richest man in the area. So now he's more rich than what he was. Now he's got more to list than what he had in the beginning. But I'm confident that this wouldn't have been the case had Job given up. I'm confident that this wouldn't have been the case had Job not chosen to continue this journey of his life. Had he just given up, there would be no realization of the greatness of the presence of God. And until you can realize that, your life is just, what, on average 82 years long, and that's all you get? No. There'd be no opportunity to love again if you gave up. There'd be no living to see four generations of his children and grandchildren if he gave up. And as a kicker, I want you to think about what greater understanding of the presence of God in eternity can bring about. Right? Because, I mean, if you think about that, the pain that you've experienced over the, for me, 41 years of life, there's some pretty deep pain. I'm still kicking. I'm still living. I'm still able to love the people that I love pretty well. I'm still enjoying life, right? And that those moments of pain compared to 41 years, it doesn't feel all that long. Maybe a pretty deep wrestle with depression for a year or so, but one out of 41 isn't terrible, right? There are a lot of other great times. And then compound that by eternity. And if eternity is heaven for you, then the bad moments shrink even more and more and more compared to eternity. So much to the point where you probably don't even realize the bad moments, because I know in heaven I will be holding my daughter. So that pain goes away the second she's in my arms, right? I know in heaven I will be hugging my mom. So that pain goes away the second that that happens. I know that I will see Jesus. So anything that could have possibly hurt me, even death, disappears in that moment, right? And let me, just kind of on a ground level here, let me ask you a question. What were the names of Job's daughters in chapter 1? Do you guys remember? Not in this last chapter, not in chapter 42, but in chapter 1. You remember their names? Yeah, because it didn't say. If you look in chapter 42, his three daughters had they were named. On the surface, it seems like a small detail, right? But I want you to think about this. In these times, in the times that Job was alive, in this part of history, women were property, not people. A lot of guys probably loved their dog more than they loved their wives, because they had multiple, okay? In this time, women weren't typically even named. They were just Job's wife or Quentin's wives, or just kidding. He's in trouble. No. Anyways, but these girls, listen, these girls, because of who they belonged to, they had an identity. Because they didn't belong to some man, they belonged to God. They were given to Job as a gift from God because of his faithfulness and because he didn't put down his freaking fork and he kept living, right? There's something about knowing who God is that allows us to know who we are. So when Job comes to realize, one, the presence of God is everything, and two, eternity is longer than the life that he lived, right? Which makes whatever pain that we feel in this lifetime feel a bit more like a bee sting, right? He's still alive and he has a responsibility to live, not just to not die, but to live. Then he can know that the best is yet to come, right? And if we can have that mindset, because let me tell you something, the same God that pulled all of this off in Job's life is the God that we serve, the God that we worship, the God that wants to be close to you, the God who sent his son to die on the cross of Calvary so that we can be reconciled back with him and have that relationship so we never have to say, I miss the days when I was close to God. I miss the days when God was in my household. I miss the days when he was having an impact on my children and my relationships and my friendships and my seasons of life. I miss those days. He's here. You don't have to miss him. You just have to recognize him. You don't have to miss him. You just have to get all the other crap out of the way so that you can see him. You've put so much in between you and God that, of course, you're going to say, I miss the presence of God. Well, move some of that crap out of the way. In Hebrews chapter 12, it says to cut off the sin and the impurities that bind us up. Cut that off. Break your stride. Make some progress. Get closer to God. Get the stuff out of the way and keep your fork. Because I honestly believe that God will bless the second half of your life even more than he has the first half of your life. But he doesn't get to do that unless you recognize who he is and the greatness of his presence. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this day. I thank you for your presence in our life, whether we recognize it or not. Father, I thank you for the blessings that we do have that we don't necessarily recognize right now. I pray that we can more often. Help us to take this holiday season to celebrate who you are and who we are because of who you are. Lord, I pray for those who are going through what seems to be that Job moment, the hard season where you feel like you're ignorant to what you're up to. Lord, I pray that you reveal to them that you are here, that you are able, that you are willing, and you are the same God today that you were then. I thank you for your son, Jesus. It's in his name I pray. Amen.
You guys can go ahead and stand.
Savior, my refuge, my hiding place. And you're my helper, my healer, my blessed redeemer, my answer, my saving grace. And you're my hope in the shadows, my strength in the battle, my anchor for all my days. And you stand by my side, and you stand in my place, Jesus, no other name. Holy Jesus, no other name. You are worthy. You are worthy of your name. You are worthy. You are worthy of your name. Yes, you are worthy. You are worthy of your name. You are worthy. You are worthy of your name. But Jesus. Who is like the Lord God Almighty? You walk on the water. You are worthy. You are worthy of your name. You are worthy.
Amen? All right, you guys have a great week and have a happy Thanksgiving. We'll see y'all.
Oh, okay.
Adam's like, you're done talking.